welcome to Greater Grace for Chester and Ellesmere Port. Welcome in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to be here together online. It feels a little bit strange talking to a camera rather than to a live group of people. And once again, we miss everyone and wish we could be together, praying for everyone, lifting you up this season. Hope you're surviving the whole thing with the virus. Hope nobody is sick, and hope that people are not going stir crazy if they're in lockdown. But this is the season that God has allowed, and we trust Him through it all. So let's pray before we do anything else, and we'll read a few scriptures and share a few thoughts. And the big advantage you have is that if you don't like it, you can just turn it off. Anyway, let's pray. First of all, Heavenly Father, we thank you. We want to praise you. First of all, your name is glorious. You are perfect in all your ways, Lord. And we want to give you the glory. We want to proclaim the name of the Lord Jesus Christ tonight over everything, Lord, over the virus, over the leadership of our country, Lord. Just really give wisdom there, Lord, over our lives, our situations, those of us that are maybe at home, unable to go out. Be with us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you never leave us or forsake us. Thank you, Lord, that you are faithful. And thank you, Lord, that you are present with each one of us, Lord. We just ask that you bless this time tonight, Lord. Bless our coming together. Bless the word as it's shared, Lord. We just ask for your anointing by your Holy Spirit on these thoughts now. Lord, we are nothing. We are no one special. But we have a big God. We have precious words of scripture that don't change. And Lord, we just ask now for your Spirit of truth, Spirit of power, Spirit of love, and a sound mind in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, we're going to read today from Romans chapter 10. We'll read from verse 13. Wow, it's good to see that there's two people watching at least. We've got Mark Bingham. Hi there, down in Bedfordshire. God bless you guys. We love you guys. And Diane Bailey, faithful as always. It's a Wednesday night, so you wouldn't be anywhere else. So let's read from Romans chapter 10, if you have a Bible. I don't have to wait for the rustling of pages, but we'll read from verse 13. It says, "For whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world." Heavenly Father, we just pray for your perfect anointing now, Lord. Touch these words, these thoughts, and bless our time now of fellowship and life. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Wow, we very different season of life. It's rather strange, different for everyone. We were speaking last week about Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the assembling together, as do some, but we are now in the situation where we actually can't physically assemble together, which is a great shame, great sadness. But God is faithful. God is still on the throne. And there is plenty to give thanks for. We've had a very sweet day today. Walking in the sunshine, we went out for a loud walk with my wife. Just talking to people, finding people, speaking to family, and just having times in the Word. So actually, this can be a great season of blessing for us as believers, and times for us to refocus on what is really important, take away all the distractions, all the things that we're usually running around doing, all the travel, and all of the things that we think that we need to do. All of that's gone, but we still have God. We still have the Word, and we still actually have each other, even though we might not be as close together as we usually would be. But just thinking of these words as well, some things don't change. Whatever is going on in the world, whatever is going on in our lives, some things do never change. It's nice to think of the fact that our God never changes. Malachi 3:6, we mentioned that the other day. Sadly, the heart of man never changes either. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Jeremiah 17:9. That's never going to change. The heart of man will always have a need, and that will never go away. But the plan of God also never changes. The gospel of Jesus Christ, that doesn't change either. And you know what? We have a beautiful thing. We have a beautiful thing when we look at God's word. What promises we have here in this chapter. Even that first verse, when you think about it, I mean, maybe we know that. Maybe we're even able to quote it on the street to people when we meet them. For whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a promise that is. That's incredible. That's amazing words. What a promise that God gives us. Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's certainty there. In a world that is full of uncertain things, and a world where actually everybody is pulling their hair out because they don't know, oh, will I get paid at the end of the month? Will my job still be there? Will the country still be there? Will I get sick? All of these uncertainties. God is a God who makes us promises that don't fail. And God is a God who gives us certainties. God deals in certainties. And I love that, the fact that we can call upon his name, and whoever calls on his name, God promises they shall be saved. That's beautiful, and it's something we should never forget. And we can build our lives on that truth and on that promise. And I love it as well, it's so open. Whoever. There's no limits. There's no limits to who. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's no special treatment. There's no bars against anyone. The only criteria, really, that God puts in place is our own humility. You know, am I prepared to call on the Lord? Am I humble enough to realize that I need a saviour? That's the only real qualification, isn't it? That do I think that this is worthwhile to call on God? Do I think that it's something that's worth doing to call on the name of the Lord? find a lot of people now that when we maybe we suggest it's good for our nation to pray, let's get back to God with everything that's going on. There are still a lot of people who are very proud and shake their fist at God and say, well, why is God killing everybody and why is it all his fault? And you know what? Humility is something that we need. Even to make that first step to call on the Lord. It's a very simple thing to do, isn't it? To call on the name of the Lord. God doesn't give us difficult tasks. It's not like we have to go to the top of Mount Everest or live in a monastery or do all these great acts. No, he says, call on my name. Call on the name of the Lord and you'll be saved. Wow. It's beautiful. It's simple, but it's powerful. And God gives us a promise in it all. And we never should forget that. Call on the name of the Lord. For the name of the Lord is central. Not unto us. Remember that? Psalm 115, isn't it? Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory. For thy mercy and for thy truth's sake. The name of the Lord. Call on the name of the Lord. There's no other name given under heaven amongst men whereby we can be saved. The name of the Lord. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth unto it and is safe. Proverbs 18:10. The name of the Lord is powerful. God gave Jesus Christ a name above every other name, the name of Jesus. Every knee should bow, every tongue confess. There is no other name. It's a beautiful name. But he who calls on that name shall be saved. Tonight's message is not going to be a big, complicated, theological one. Just simply this. Call on the name of the Lord. We need to call on his name. You know, we don't respond if nobody asks us, do we? If sometimes I occasionally find out that somebody in the church has a problem, has a need. And it's like, you think, oh, why didn't you call me? You know, I could have helped you with this. I could have been praying for it. And we find out after the fact that actually, you know, oh, this has been going on. But, you know, we can't respond if we don't get called on. And God's the same, you know. He who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know, we need to call on God's name. There's never been a time in our nation's history, well, not for a long time, when we've needed so much to call on the name of the Lord. This is where salvation comes from. And this is the power that we have as believers. And I love this. And I love what really drew me to preach on this passage. Sometimes, you know, we wait on the Lord and he maybe just gives us one verse on our heart. And it was verse 14. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how then shall they believe on him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Wow. There's a lot in that verse already. Really, just a few things, but people can't call on God if they don't believe in him. There needs to be that first step, doesn't there? That needs to be that acknowledgement that actually, yeah, there is a God there and he's powerful and he can do something. If I don't believe in God, I'm not going to call on nothing. People are desperately seeking for some answers and people are desperately seeking for someone to make a difference. Oh, the government needs to make a difference. The doctors need to make a difference. The scientists need to make a difference. The World Health Organization. You know what? makes a difference. God is there to make a difference. He loves us. And he makes a difference. He's made a way. He's given us his son. He's given us the perfect sacrifice to make a difference in every one of our lives. He's given us the Lord of healing. He's given us the power of his word. He's given us truth. But like we said earlier, there needs to be that first little step of humility and saying, wow, maybe I could be wrong. And maybe this God could be there. And maybe he's right. And maybe I need him. Maybe I need him more than I realize. And maybe this world needs him more than it realizes. How shall they call on him if they don't believe? And how shall they believe on him if they've not heard? You know, it's a scandal, but most weeks, maybe not so much just at the moment because of obviously we can't go out and social distancing, but most other weeks of the year, as a church, we go out, a group of us, a small group of us, go out on the streets to tell people that God loves them, that actually sin is a barrier, our failings, just missing the mark, nothing condemning, but we're not perfect, but that God has made everything available through his son Jesus Christ. Like every parent would do, he's taken the responsibility for his children's failings. The Lord Jesus Christ went to the cross for us. He died for us. But he rose again in power. And death is defeated. And there's a plan there. But we take this simple gospel truth, this message of love and this message of restoration out to people on the streets every week. We guarantee that probably 80% of the people that we speak to on the street will say, wow, I've never heard this before. You know, it's a sort of a scandal, really, that we have this Christian country, supposedly Christian country, and yet so many people, they don't know what the gospel is. They don't know who Jesus is. They don't know what God has done for them. How will they call on someone that they've never heard of? How will they call out if they've not heard the message of grace? How will they know which God to speak to if people don't actually explain to them who God is? It's very sad. But it's a challenge to us. It's a challenge to very much more so in the circumstances we find ourselves in, because maybe we can't go up to a complete stranger and talk to them. We saw a few people on the street today, but we were the other side of the road from them, keeping the social distance and keeping a healthy distance away. But somehow we need to get the message out about the Lord Jesus Christ. How will they call on him that they don't believe in? How will they believe on him if they've not heard of him? And how will they hear without a preacher? Wow. It's our job to proclaim the Lord Jesus Christ and his power. It's our job to make that message known. It's our job to express the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Compassion. Boldness. In a time when actually people are very fearful, very uncertain, the confidence that we can have. You know, we don't cast away our confidence. And the confidence we have in quietness is powerful. It's a testimony to this world. Why are we not afraid? Why is it that this constant fear of death that the media is pushing out to people, why does that not concern us as much? It's because we know what happens after death. We know the God who loves us. We know who created us. And we know that we're made for a purpose. And also we know that we have a saviour. We have someone who's there to rescue us. And someone who's there to pick up the pieces. And someone who's transformed the life that we have. That we're not the people that we used to be. Praise the Lord. And we're not perfect. But you know what? Our God has made a difference. And we need to get this message out. We are the preachers, aren't we? How will they preach except they've been sent? Oh, well, you see, that's all very well because, you know, Pastor, you're a preacher, so obviously you've been sent. So, you know, I understand it's up to you. That's fair enough, isn't it? You know, that you've been sent to be have a calling as a preacher. You know what? No, we all do. Every one of us, if we're a Christian, the Lord Jesus Christ is the one who sends us. Yes, you know what? Get taught, get built up, go to Bible college. Yeah, that's wonderful. That's great. Get called, get sent out as a missionary by a ministry. Yes, that's fine. But you know what? For every one of us, the Lord Jesus Christ says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. There it is again. A nice firm promise from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. You shall be saved. You believe. Get baptized. That's just an outward sign that you are testifying that you believe. But he that believeth not shall be damned. Wow. Powerful. Scary words. But from the Lord Jesus Christ himself, gracious God, a loving Saviour, but also a God of justice, we mustn't lose sight of the fact that, yes, those that reject what the Lord Jesus Christ did, you know, there is a consequence to that. There is a serious consequence to that. And we don't like to focus on that a lot of the time as believers, but it's true. He that believes not shall be damned. Wow. Eternally cursed. That also should motivate us as believers to be preachers of the gospel and of truth. If we see people we know, people we care about, people we work with, people in our families, you know, we want to get that message out there that the Lord Jesus Christ loves them and that salvation is so easy for us. Call upon the name of the Lord. Call upon the name of the Lord and you'll be saved. That's beautiful. It's not complicated. If you're a Christian, you've been sent. And then, yeah, I love that quote as well. That it's quoting from Isaiah 52:7, isn't it? How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. You know, we said the other day as well, this world desperately needs good news, doesn't it? It desperately needs some truth, something firm, but also something positive. The end of the news broadcasts, they always look for these like little feel-good stories about a dog with a wounded paw or something like that, or something silly, or, you know, or someone who's done something for charity. And they desperately look for some good news. We have the good news. And actually, our feet are blessed when we go out and we take that good news and we take the positivity of a Saviour who is Christ the Lord. We take that positivity of a a God who came to earth, of a perfect one who is without sin, who laid down his life and paid a price that he didn't owe, that actually wipes our slate completely clean. That's good news. That's good news. I'm forgiven. I'm brand new. I have a fresh start. You know, that's good news. Let's get that out there. We desperately need to that. And our feet are beautiful when we take good news. People want to see us. People are glad that they see us coming towards them if it's good news. That's the point. But you know what? Moving on to verse 17 again. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Wow. It's a great mystery in many ways. Faith comes by hearing. There's a power in God's word, isn't there? When we hear it, the sound of God's word, of scripture falling on our ear, it has an impact on us, and it has an effect. Maybe it will harden us. Maybe it will be something that we want to reject. Maybe a lot of people turn away from it if they hear preaching. Maybe we see that if someone is preaching on the street, you can see the glazing over expression of someone thinking, oh no, somebody who's religious, I don't want to hear that. But actually there's also power in it. There's power that goes into the human soul. It goes directly through the hearing of man, deep into the heart of man. And faith comes by that hearing. It's a crazy thing. How will they believe if they've not heard? Faith comes by that hearing. The power of God's word. Think about it as well for a minute, the power of God's word. And again, it's a scripture maybe we often quote, but Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now again, just think about that for a minute. There's so much in that verse. God's word is quick. It's alive. It's powerful. It has an impact. It's not weak. It's not ineffective. It has a purpose. Sharper than any two-edged sword. The word of God can do things that actually nothing on earth else can do. It can actually bring a soul to the point of salvation. That's something actually nothing else can do. It can convict a soul. It can turn a life around. It can reveal things. Piercing and dividing us under the soul and the spirit. I love that verse, because you know what we need? This world and us as believers, we desperately need our soul and our spirit to be divided from one another. The soul with its desires and its intellect and its emotions and its thoughts and its will and all of these parts of the human psyche. We still use that word today, don't we? Psychos, which is the soul. But the spirit, the things of God, the spiritual side of man, these things are different. We become a new creation. We become a spiritual entity. And we take on something that is new. And the word of God is able to clarify that. How do you feel today? How are you you're feeling in yourself. Talk about your emotions. No. Talk about something spiritual. What has God done in your life today? What is the Spirit of God revealing to you today? Now that's different. You know, which is going to edify us? Oh, myself and my problems and the things that I've thought about today and the things that I saw on the TV and the worries I have. Or actually, you know, what did the Word of God teach me today? What did the Spirit of God reveal by God's Word? Piercing asunder, dividing like a skillful surgeon does. The joints from the marrow. Wow, the outer edge of a bone from the inner productive part of the bone. The hard, cold top part where the joints, for those of us who are slightly over 50 now, the joints, they start to creak. Why? Because one bone rubs against another. It's the hard bit. And yes, there's nice supple cartilage in between. Or inside the bone, there is softness, there is moisture, there is life, there is the healing white blood cells. And you know what? The Word of God divides the joints from the marrow, but spiritually speaking as well, the cold outward part of man and the soft life-giving part as well that God wants to put in there, his life source. Then the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart, wow. You know what? That's a whole new Bible study, really, isn't it? We could do that for the whole time, really. The thoughts and intents of the heart. Well, do we want them to be revealed? Probably not, actually, most of the time. But do we want them to be divided? Yeah, actually, we do need them to be divided, don't we? But this is the Word of God, the power of God's Word. And faith comes by hearing the Word of God. And the Word of God comes into my life. It has that impact. And it does something that nothing else can do. Let's just go in closing maybe over to verse 20. We didn't actually read that far when we were reading it. But verse 20 of Romans 10 says, but Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not, and I made manifest unto them that asked not after me. Wow, could it be that there's somebody out there today who actually was never expecting to seek God? Could there be someone who actually is thinking, you know what, the last thing I want to do is hear about God. But actually, deep down, they desperately need to hear what God is saying to them. Could it be that there are people who are actually not seeking God, but actually God is there to be found by them? Well, were any of us seeking God really when he revealed himself to us, or were we all happy to go our own way? You know, were we all happy to do our own thing? But God doesn't allow us just to go on in ourselves the whole time. Why? Because he loves us and he has a better plan for us. And he desperately wants to do something in our life, produce something new in our life. And even the times when maybe we feel dry and fed up, and we don't want to, I'm not even gonna read anything today. I can't even pray today. You know what? God is saying, no. Even when you don't seek me, I'm seeking you. Even when you're not seeking me, I've been desperately looking for you. I went to the cross for you, and I love you. And that's never gonna change. Praise God. Hey, God bless you guys. It's been good to be here. If you're still watching, thank you. Greetings, and hopefully we will be able to see each other in, I was going to say in the flesh, but that doesn't sound good actually for believers. See each other in the spirit, in the spiritual reality that is ourselves when we meet as the body of Christ. Take care. God bless. Heavenly Father, bless these precious saints in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be with them. Keep each one safe, Lord, now. Thank you for each one. Thank you for each precious friend, each loved one, each believer, each true soldier of the gospel, and each one who shares their faith. And Lord, we just ask a blessing on our nation and on this world as well that is so sick, sick with sin, sick with everything, with the reality of its own weakness, Lord. We just pray that you would bless now. And we want to see you come through, Lord. Touch hearts as well tonight, we pray.